Hello, this is Connie Belden, and today we're going to talk about adjusting entries. The information I'm looking at here is available in your Chapter 3 instructor notes. So if you want to pause the video and bring those up, you can, or you could just follow along on your screen. I've actually gone to the end of the chapter notes first because I want to talk about that adjusting entries are really in five categories: deferred expenses, which means they were previously recorded as an asset; deferred revenues, which means they were previously recorded as a liability, such as an unearned; accrued expenses and accrued revenues, which neither one of those were previously recorded; and depreciation. So let's start with deferred expenses. As you purchase supplies, or you prepay rent, or you prepay insurance, those are all treated as an asset. Once you use them up, or once they expire, that's when you need to adjust for them and turn the used or expired amount into an expense. These adjusting entries, you've seen some of them before, but keep in mind they are normally done at the end of each accounting period in order to adjust the accounts to the proper balances. So let's go ahead and look at deferred expenses first. So I'm going to back up in my chapter notes. A good example of deferred expenses would be the use of supplies. Let's assume that you previously purchased some supplies for $2,000. You would have debited the asset supplies because it's an asset until you use it up. Now, a lot of this chapter is just the terminology. It can be kind of tricky. So what if they did an inventory of the stock room and determined there were $760 worth of supplies on hand? That would be the amount of supplies left. Or in other words, there should be $760 in the asset account of supplies at the end. So if you subtract, that means you used up $1,240 worth of supplies. No matter how it's given to you in the problem, it's the amount that you used that you want to turn into a supplies expense. So in this case, the adjusting entry would be to debit supplies expense for the amount used of $1,240 and credit or take it out of supplies. That will leave $760 in the supplies account, the amount on hand. Another example of a deferred would be for when a prepaid is used up. Let's use insurance as an example. Let's assume that you prepaid an insurance policy of $2,400. Now, with insurance, we usually say expired for the amount that's used up, since insurance is not a tangible asset. So let's assume that $100 of it has expired. Therefore, if you subtract, you still have $2,300 that is unexpired. So therefore, to journalize for the amount of the insurance policy that has been used up or it expired, you would turn it into an expense. So you would debit insurance expense and credit prepaid insurance. This happens quite frequently because you normally pay insurance policies in advance. Now, let's take a look at deferred revenues. We talked about unearned in Chapter 2. So an example of a deferred revenue would be anything that's unearned: unearned rent, unearned fees, unearned subscriptions. For example, if somebody pays you in advance for rent, but then let's say, for example, the building burned down so they're unable to rent it from you would really owe them that rent back. If you bought tickets to a concert, the individual putting on the concert cannot count it as revenue. They actually count it as unearned until the concert is played. Because what if for some reason the concert doesn't end up being played because a performer is sick? If they don't reschedule it, they would owe you the money back. So therefore, anything that's paid to you in advance is considered an unearned. When you actually perform the service or earn the money, then it becomes an earned amount, a revenue. Okay, so let's say, for example, we're renting a building to another company for $120 a month. They paid us 3 months in advance, so they paid us in advance $360. So the initial recording would be a debit to cash, a credit to unearned, a liability for $360 because we haven't earned it yet. Now, after 1 month has gone by, we have earned $120 of it. So therefore, as we earn it, we will take it out of the unearned and credit, in this case, rent revenue. If it was for unearned fees, we would debit unearned fees and credit fees earned. Okay, let's take a look at accruals. Remember, accruals have not previously been recorded. Let's say that wages of $250 have been accrued or earned by our employees, but we don't pay them until next month. So therefore, we would journalize it as wages expense and credit wages payable. Why are we doing this? Because these adjusting entries help to ensure that we are following the matching principle, that we're recording the wages expense when it incurred, not when it's paid. So notice I credit wages payable instead of cash because I haven't paid it yet. Accrued fees. Okay, that's basically revenue that has been earned but not recorded yet, or we've agreed that they don't have to pay us yet. Think about a lawyer who has agreed to take on your case. You may have an agreement with that lawyer that you don't pay them any revenues or any fees until the case is actually won. However, the lawyer is accumulating fees as the case goes along. For example, you may go see a doctor. The doctor's earned that fee, but they've agreed not to bill you your part until they bill the insurance company. So what you do is you just pretend like you're billing for it, but you don't actually send them a bill. So you perform $500 worth of services, but you've agreed not to bill till next month. You would debit account receivable, credit fees earned. For depreciation, that's pretty easy. Whenever you have an asset like land, building, equipment, auto, keep in mind though that land does not normally depreciate. So we'll stick with buildings, equipment, auto. You would just debit depreciation expense and credit accumulated depreciation dash whatever the asset is, equipment, auto, building, etc. So how will these look on the financial statements? Well, you actually look at this a little deeper in Chapter 4, but let's go ahead and take a look at it here. These adjusting entries would reduce assets such as supplies and prepaids. Now, where would the accumulated depreciation go? Well, the accumulated depreciation would follow right below the asset. So you would have an accumulated depreciation account for each asset that depreciates. So land, again, does not have any depreciation. So next we have equipment. Its cost was $70,000. Let's assume it's depreciated by $5,000. So that falls immediately below it. Then we have auto. Its cost is $10,000. Followed by its accumulated depreciation is $4,000. So notice accumulated depreciation falls below the respected account. Now, what you do then in the middle here is that $65,000 and that $6,000 represents book value. And we get book value by taking the cost minus accumulated depreciation. So 70 minus 5 is a book value of 65. So again, book value is defined by cost less accumulated depreciation. Don't add. 10,000 minus 4,000 gives you a book value of $6,000. We'll take a look at the financial statements a little bit deeper in the next chapter, but I hope this helps you with adjusting entries. Thank you very much.